Welcome students. I'm very sorry I could not conduct the live class today because of some very serious internet issues and I just could not reconcile them. So this is my ninth class with you that I am uploading and recording for your purpose. And just a short revision and then we will move on to our next topic, to the topic that we have at hand, that is Kipling's ambivalence. So up till now we had just a quick revision. Up till now we had studied things such as how Kipling represented the natives, how Kipling had represented the colonizers as well, or we had discussed the novel Kim adjacent to Bakhtin's theory of dialogism, and we had discussed about the split that occurs within Kipling, that is the ambivalence that we have been talking about, and previously we had discussed the split that occurs within the other. So the split or the clash of identity, self-identity, it occurs both within the self and also within the other. We had also seen how Kipling, in the process of otherizing the colonized nation of India, also exposes his own prejudices against his own country, against the imperialist project as well, how he was skeptical towards his own country and how he was skeptical towards his own call of patriotism. We had learned about the importance of dialogism, which is again a Bakhtinian idea. We had learned and applied it to the novel. We had learned about heteroglossia, and I had sent you materials regarding the other concepts that we can readily use, the post-colonial concepts that we can readily use and apply to our novel, to the novel that we have at hand. I had sent you materials and I hope that you have studied them. We had also seen that how Kipling tried to put Kipling in this process of, you know, being a colonizer and also someone who sympathizes with the colonized. He actually becomes a recorder of history, of the cultural clashes that existed at that point of time. And today we will learn about how Kipling saw India and what India was to him and what England was to him. We will be reading about that today. So the first thing that we realize when we are reading the novel is that there is a certain resistance, there is a certain pause, or there is a certain thrust of external force that we get from within the novel that stops us from reading it very smoothly. So the novel does not present to us a very smooth reading experience, and this is not the narrative that I am talking about. It is not that the plot is indented. No, I am talking about the reading experience. So when I am reading, when I am sitting with a book in my hand and I am trying to read it in a smooth flow of fashion, like I would like to read a Thomas Hardy's novel or a Charles Dickens novel or Victorian writers, a Jane Austen novel, they have a very smooth narrative of plot to plot, from subplot to subplot. But when I'm reading Kim, there is a certain form of resistance that I feel. And this is very much because of the fact that the problem in reading Kipling is understanding the complexity of his attitude towards imperialism and the unified individual subject as agent. So there is a clash that we witness over here, because of which we feel that resistance while reading the novel. The first is that Kipling's own attitude towards imperialism, towards the project, towards the colonizing agenda that his own country has had for several centuries, that his own nation has had for several centuries. Kipling's attitude toward that very project was somewhat very much unreliable. He was very prejudicial towards the agenda of his own country. He was not fully in support of the nature of the colonizers, of the imperial agenda, of how it had become during the age of Queen Victoria. He was certainly disheartened by the shape that the imperialist project had taken. He was somewhat prejudicial towards it, and at the same time he was also exercising his own self as an agent. Self as an agent means that it's nothing but the subjectivity that I am talking about. So if I am a subject and if I am a self, then I am an agent of certain activities. That is, I have the intellect, that is, I have the drive, the desire, and I have the will to act towards something. I have the power to act towards something, and that I am also accountable for it. That is what I mean by the subject as an agent, that you have the will to act and also the desire to act upon your wishes, and also feel the need to be accountable for your own actions. So Kipling was also being his own agent. He was acting out his own consciousness, and there was this is the conflict that existed between his own prejudicial ideas towards his own country's imperialist project, and also the growing negativity which was surrounding that entire the entire picture of the empire, the negativity that was, the grayness that was surrounding, that was being slowly superimposed upon the bigger image of the imperialist project. So there was this first split that occurs, that is his own attitude towards imperialism and himself as a unified subject, as an agent. So what you can see in front of you, if you see the speech bubbles, you will see that they're very much contradictory to each other. They do not fall in similar lines if you can read it closely. So in contrast to Kipling's family back in England, who were a very acute representative of the metropolitan colonial mind, Kipling's family back in England, it was a very very apt representative, the ideals of his family was a very apt representative of the metropolitan colonial mind. And in contrast to this kind of sentiment that was supported by his family, in contrast to this sentiment, he mocks and fragments, he kind of jests at or mocks at and fragmentarizes or dismantles the idea of both India and colonial identity as something that is fixed. So what I am trying to say is that what he wanted to prove, or what the stance that he took, was that he did not consider the colonial identity or the colonized identity to be fixed. That is the saying that the sun of the empire never sets. There is a proverb that goes like this, that the sun never sets on the empire. That is a very famous proverb that was formulated back at the time of colonization. So the sun never sets for the empire. So this idea that the colonial identity will remain fixed throughout ages, and the idea that the identity of the colonized nations, India in this case, will remain fixed and will never change, the status will never change, this is something that Kipling did not believe in, which was very much contradictory to what his family back in England believed in. And at the same time, he also acknowledged the fact that in order to prove this proverb, because he was also an Englander, right? He was also a British imperial official. So at that same point of time, he also acknowledges the fact and gives substantial importance to the realization that in order to maintain the imperial project of England, there is a very acute necessity to fix this colonial identity. That is, the proverb that the sun never sets over the empire should remain constant and should remain true throughout decades and throughout centuries. So he played flute to both of these melodies. on one hand, he said that it is not possible that colonial identity will be fixed throughout the centuries because time is dynamic, because context changes, and with time and with place, with new methods of rule and new methods of resistances, new ways of revolution, new instances of rebellions, all of these things they are bound to alter the colonial identity. They are bound to alter the identity of the colonized nation as well. And at the same time, he also acknowledges the fact that it is necessary that there remain fixity in imperial mythology, in the myth that the sun never sets for the empire. People need to believe in it constantly, and this truth must remain fixed. So this is a contradiction. This is a contradiction that we find very easily. That will be very easy to be found in his own autobiographies, in the letters that he wrote to his friends, some of which I had discussed in the last class, in the sketches that he would make during earlier in his career, that I had also discussed in the last class. And in a very similar vein, this contradiction also existed in his authorial stance, in the stance that he took as an author. So too, in his authorial stance towards that other with the capital O, is self-conscious, is very much self-conscious and accepting in its recognition that the narrator, who is constructed by a system that is entirely racist, and he makes his narrator like himself too. So what I want to say is that when he is penning the author of Kim, or when he is creating the novel, his authorial stance towards that other, the Kim is also the other, Kim is the self, Kim is also the other. So there is a split within Kim, double split that occurs within the narrator of the Kim. In a very similar vein, the fact that his ambivalence towards the imperial identity, this ambivalence also existed towards his approach towards the other, while he was creating that other, the narrator. And this authorial stance towards the other is self-conscious. Kim is very self-conscious, and Kim recognizes the author Kipling recognizes that his narrator, who is constructed by a system which is unitarily, uniformly racist, Kipling realizes that his narrator is constructed within a narrative, within a space, within a place, within a time that was very much racist, which was unitarily, which was uniformly racist. And at the same time, Kim, or the narrator, having a supportive stance towards imperialism, echoes, very much blots out or echoes, this mindlessly echoes the very same racial spirit of the colonizers. So Kipling, while he thinks, Kipling who thinks that it is important to necessitate a fixed identity of the colonial power, Kipling creates a narrator who mindlessly echoes the racist voice that also creates Kim. Yet at the same time, the narrator leads us, Kim leads us towards a diversity of cultural experience that is frequently forbidden, dangerous, otherworldly, or exotic. So Kim, as I said, who is doubly split within his own mind, within his own body, Kim is ruffed black, but he is still white. So this is a very contradictory statement that is made within the novel. So Kipling creates a narrator who mindlessly echoes the very racist voices that makes him, and at the same time Kipling makes his narrator encounter experiences or take up journeys that give us, the readers, a very panoramic view of the cultural diversity that existed in India at that point of time. And such activities in real life at that point of time, and for an author who, and for an imperial author who has to undergo so many kinds of censorships, because he is writing, he's supposed to be writing from the point of view of power, right? At that point of time, if the British officials knew that 200 years down the line, Kipling's novel will be read as a challenge to imperialism, then they wouldn't have supported its publication at all. It would have been censored, it would have been banned, Kipling would have been jailed. And he had oftentimes gotten into trouble because of this very complex stance that he took towards his own nation. So as I was saying that at the same, so Kipling through his narrator does represents this ambivalence that exists in his own mind. Kipling as a person, Kipling as an agent, as his own self is contradictory. He thinks that identity cannot be fixed, and at the same time he thinks that it is important that the imperial myth remain unchanged. And this contradiction he represents through his narration, through his narrator as well, and therefore creates a narrator like Kim, who, living in India, living in that racist colonized country, echoes the voice of the colonizers, and at the same time undertakes journeys, and at the same time encounters experiences that exposes or that reveals the cultural diversity that existed in India at that point of time. Now remember that diversity is not supposed to exist from the point of view of power. Power, as I have said again and again, power will always try to homogenize. So as I have also given a few examples from the novel as well, which reinstates this fact, how power tries to homogenize differences, how it tries to erase differences. Yet at the same time, Kipling, an imperial author, creates a racist narrator who undertakes journeys, who encounters experiences that in the process throughout the novel reveals the cultural diversity that existed in India at that point of time, and which is that was frequently forbidden, dangerous, otherworldly, or exotic. And in this manner, his narrators, both from Kim as well as other narrators that I some works that I had discussed previously, they prepare us. They reinscribe this ambivalence. The narrators reinforces the ambivalence and anxiety. Anxiety, something which I had also spoken about in the last class, the ambivalence and the anxiety as part of the defining discourse of colonialism and of the contradictions within it. This prepares us for his narrator. So this contradictory stance, it reinscribes the ambivalence and the anxiety which was a part and parcel of the defining discourse of colonialism, that which defined the discourse of colonialism and of the contradictions within it. They prepared us for his omnipresent narrator, ubiquitous narrator, a narrator like an omnipresent author, like an omnipresent self, like God, like power, like the Christian God, like power. So they prepare us for this omnipresent narrator whose attempts to impose an exaggeratedly monologic, recognizably official colonial stance on an embedded story creates the slippery and oppositional strategy that marks Kipling's work. So even though we find Kim in the novel being omnipresent and trying to overpower or impose his own very questionable stance of superiority, he tries to impose his superiority upon everyone else that he meets. So he tries to impose this exaggeratedly monologic, and which we recognize as an official colonial stance. He tries to impose this on an embedded story, but at the same time, because he is doubly split within himself, like Kipling himself. So while the narrator tries to impose his very superfluous superiority upon the other people, upon all of the other characters, upon the entire narrative, upon the entire plot of the novel, in the process of trying to impose, he creates the slippery and very contradictory and oppositional strategy. That is the very mark of Kipling's work or Kipling's novel, Kim. So Kim himself is the reason why the novel becomes a counter strategy towards the imperial agenda. So even if the imperialists have been successful in whitening the mind of Kim, even if the imperial agenda has been successful in a manner, if I suppose, even then, while Kim tries to impose his superfluous and very hollow superiority upon each and every character that he meets, while he does that, he creates a very slippery ground, and he creates the oppositional strategy that we use to counter the discourse of colonialism. This is the very subversion and containment of subversion that I was talking about when I was reading Invisible Bullets with you. So even if I find that there is subversion in a novel and the subversion is contained in the novel, even then, I as a scholar, the readers, this clash between the subversion and containment that occurs within any narrative, this clash creates chinks in the armor or little gaps within the entire wall of the empire through which we can witness the real ambivalence, we can witness the real slippery grounds and the real oppositional strategies that exist within the colonial discourses. So in talking about Kipling's own life, what made him so, you know, skeptical towards his own nation? See, in 1897, that is just 4 years before Kim was published. In 1897, Kipling was suffering from depression, which, as he describes in his own biography, that is Something of Myself, which is his biography, he describes in his biography as gathering blackness of the mind and sorrow of the heart. So he was suffering from depression, and he writes in his own biography that which was gathering blackness of the mind and sorrow of the heart. It can be interpreted, this depression that he was suffering from, it can be interpreted as a determined event provoked by the threatening collapse of many sustaining structures of the empire, by turning points in what would be called the imperial sunset. As you can see, the name of this book is also such, Imperial Sunset. So the sun never sets on the empire, here is overturning in its own discourse. So at that point of time, in that decade of the 1890s, lots of things were happening. And Kipling's depression can be interpreted as a determined event which was provoked by the threatening collapse of the empire in many places in which it had sustained itself. And this could be called the imperial sunset. The government of ever decreasing empires, it was becoming clear, also depended on contradiction. Since the British government was declining slowly since the 1800s, since the Victorian England, the condition of the empire quote unquote with capital E, it is deteriorating. It is constantly shrinking in its size. So the government of ever decreasing empires, it was becoming clear, dependent on contradiction. The contradiction which you can see in front of you. So this decade, the decade of 1890s, had seen the emergence of the US as US and Imperial Germany as new naval and imperial powers. US was rising as the new West, and Imperial Germany was rising up to becoming the Nazi Germany that it would be in a few years, in the next few years. And they were the new naval and imperial powers in the world. And there were increasing hostilities between Britain and Russia for control over parts of the globe bordering on Russia, such as Persia, Afghanistan, Northwest India and China. England constantly feigned, it constantly rejected or ignored the fact that it depended on such imperial structures which were now falling down. And these structures, they were the land whose these structures, the empire was dependent, sorry, England was dependent on these imperial structures, and these imperial structures, they were dismantling itself slowly. And England was completely ignorant of the fact. It was blissfully ignorant of the fact. And Kipling was very, he vehemently criticized these exact people who lived in England and who were the higher ranking officials of the empire, and they remained blissfully ignorant of their dismantling structures of the empire in various places of the world upon which England was very much dependent upon. So, and Kipling was very much against and very much criticizing, he had a very much criticizing attitude towards the ignorant stance that England was taking at that very crucial point when the empire was falling down. It was tumbling down, and England did nothing to improve the conditions within these empirical structures around the world. It did nothing to curb the rebellions. It did nothing to pacify the revolutionaries. It did nothing to improve the relations between the colonizer and the colonized. And Kipling was vehemently criticizing this attitude in his own autobiography. So the 1890s or the 1897 particularly, very precisely, it was also the time when England was facing resistances from the farthest sides of its colonies, such as Australia even. It was also the time when the Boer resistance started, or which led to the Boer Wars later on, which Thomas Hardy had written so many poems upon, one of which I will show in front of you because it is an excellent poem and I think that you should learn about it. And there is a connection over here. They were both Victorian writers. Of course, Hardy extended his writing to early modern era also. Hardy was also known as the first modern writer. He kind of heralded the modern era that was to come, even though he technically belonged to the Victorian era. So at that point of time in the 1890s, there was also the Boer resistance, which Thomas Hardy had written so many poems upon. But in the midst of all this, in the midst of all of this, all of these resistances and the dismantling of so many structures of the empire which England depended upon, yet it was so ignorant, in the midst of all these, came the Diamond Jubilee celebration of Queen Victoria. And the certain optimism which the event provoked, it scared Kipling very much, as he so vehemently criticizes in his biography. He criticizes in his, the celebration of the Diamond Jubilee of Queen Victoria in his biography as well. His immediate reaction to this celebration was to write a poem called Recessional. The poem was called Recessional, and it was a warning against a land which was drunk with sight of power. So the words that he uses are very, very important in understanding his own ambivalence. He is talking about his own country over here. He is saying that his own land is drunk with sight of power. And after the Jubilee, Kipling and his family, they sailed to South Africa, a land whose color and light and manners, it reawakened the repressed nostalgia for India that Kipling had in his heart. And the year, and the very next year, that is in 1898, Kipling returned to work most intensely on Kim. It was also the year, 1898 was also the year that saw new personal and political crisis. The death of his closest uncle, Edward Burns Jones, and the beginnings of his sister Trix's mental illness. His sister named Trix. Her mental illnesses also began in the year 1898, the year which his most, in which his most closest uncle died, the year in which Kipling returned to work most intensely on his novel Kim. 1898 is also generally recognized by historians as the turning point in Britain's imperial connections, the start of England's self-perception as the weary titan. Titan means a king, and England expresses itself as a weary titan, as expressed by so many historians at that point of time. It was the beginning, 1898 was the year which marked the beginning of alliances that England would enter into. They were known as ententes. History boy gulor kotha ami jodi mone kore thako, triple entente, double entente, erokom alliances hochhilo tokhon khub beshi bhabe. So this was the year that saw the beginning of ententes or alliances with France and Russia against Germany, and the end of the Anglo-Japanese alliance. This was the end of the Anglo-Japanese alliance, an end which resurrected in the burning of Pearl Harbor and re-resurrected itself in greater concerns with the blastings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So this 1898 also saw the destruction of the US battleships, beginnings of Spanish-American War, and Kipling's friendship with Theodore Roosevelt. Kipling's warning to the English had now expanded to include the Americans. Germany's entry into a new phase of open rivalry with Britain and the Russians, designs on British territory, they were the subject of Kipling's satires. They were the subject of Kipling's mind, his own satiric and ironical viewpoints towards his own country. And this was the year in which Kipling began working the most intensely on his novel Kim. So we can very well gauge the impact that all of these events that would have, this political and personal crisis that he was facing at that point of time, and they were very much impactfully witnessed in the very much ambivalent nature of the novel itself. And And therefore, Kim, which was published just 3 years, that is from 1898, 3 years down the line, in 1901 it was first published, which was, Kim was also the product of 7 years of Kipling's wanderings through Africa, Australia, New Zealand, once again India and the United States. It came after the Jungle Books. Kim came after the Jungle Books, after his marriage, his children, and the death of Josephine, his wife. The novel captures both the fear of loss and the nostalgia for a lost Indian past, a lost dream of possibility for an eternal childhood in an imagined India. Eternal childhood, something that should remind you of another text that we read together, another Victorian text that we had read together, that is Huckleberry Finn. I remember speaking about the eternal child that Huck was, that Huck is, rather. So Kim is also a present representation of the fear, the loss, the nostalgia for a lost Indian past, the lost dream of a possibility for an eternal childhood in an imagined India. It was a fantasy of integration between the oppositional roles of the colonizer and colonized, and of the master who rules and the child who desires. It is also the result of a profound alienation from an England in which Kipling had not yet found what he was to call his own house, that ultimate home which was to be Bateman's, Jason Bateman's in Sussex. Yet, ironically, Kim announces, even as it laments, the novel Kim, it announces, while it laments, Kipling's choice of England over India. And that is why, in spite of so much studies and scholarly works upon Kipling's ambivalence that tries to put him in a very protective or defensive stance towards being completely imperialist in nature, which Kipling was not, so as we have been discussing for so long, yet in the novel we find that Kipling favors England over India. And this is what makes Kim, the novel, a discourse of colonialism, through which we find how Kipling, as an imperial agent, tries to otherize India. But while he does that, he exposes his own ambivalence. He exposes his own dreams of an eternal childhood roaming in the night streets, in the streets of nighttime Lahore. He could not live that for an entirety of life. He had to come back to reality. And that is why the reality is also this, that Kim, the novel, even as it laments Kipling's choice of England over India. And therefore, we have this novel Kim. We have this novel Kim, which is at once a spy thriller, a picaresque novel, adventure story, a maturation, a Bildungsroman. It is a quest romance in the sense that we have of the medieval sense, that is a quest that designated a quest. For an object, quest for something, for a victory, the Arthurian romances of the medieval England. That romance, it is also, Kim is also like a quest romance. Its complexity comes in part from the curious stacking up of all of these genres. It is a spy thriller, it intermittently pursues the problem of whether or not Kim and his llama will stop the Russians. As a picaresque adventure, it follows Kim's pursuits of the great game along the Grand Trunk Road of life. As a maturation story, it offers a variation on the familiar 19th century theme of the search for a father, in its embodiment of a fragmented culture in multiple father figures, as we had also studied in Huckleberry Finn. You can draw these associations, the search for the other, the eternal youth, the search for the father, that is, that Huck also travels through the novel in search of an ideal father figure, which he never does, and hence stays in his youth or stays an adolescent forever. So this is came as a Bildungs Roman, as a picaresque novel, sorry, as a picaresque adventure, as a Bildungs novel, novel, as I said, as a Bildungs Roman, as a maturation story. It offers a variation on the familiar 19th century theme of the search of the father in its embodiment of a fragmented culture in multiple father figures. As a quest story, as a quest romance, Kim involves two antithetical searches: Kim's for the red bull on a green field and the lama's for the river of the arrow. But even more importantly, it's Kim's complexity results from its efforts to negotiate the effects of death of the father. The death of the father here is again a very psychoanalytically charged phrase. Death of the father who represents the authority, who represents power, who represents the self, represents the ideal, the perfection, something that which a child wants to become, something that the child fears that if he does not become, that he will be castrated. The anxiety of castration that Freud had spoken about, that I had also discussed with you while we were reading Hamlet. And so this is what I was saying, that most importantly, the complexity of the novel rises in its efforts to negotiate with the effect that had as a result of the death of the father, the death of the self, the death of the empire, the death of the consciousness, the death of the superior colonizing agency. And the novel mediates the contrary. And in the process, it shows the entangled relations, the entangled demands of power and of love. And these negotiations with which the novel surpasses, which the novel transcends any particular genre, that it cannot be contained, that the novel cannot be contained within any one single genre. It is not just a Bildungs Roman, it is not just a quest romance, it is not just a picaresque novel, it is not just a, as I said, it is not just a spy thriller. The novel is all of these things, and as such, it mediates the contrary demands of power and love, and at the same time, it exposes the superimposition, the overlapping, the entangled demands of power and love. And these contradictions, these negotiations, we will be studying in greater detail in the next class. So I will stop till here, and of course I will repeat myself. If you find any issues, any problems, then please come up with them, post them in the class, in classroom itself, or come up to me personally. I will be posting this recording along with some materials, supporting materials, so please find it on Google Classroom. Thank you very much. See you in the next class.